I think we'll wait till the end for questions. I think we'll wait until the end for questions. Please write down your questions. Now, one of the problems that we are coming to is hard to believe, like him. You know, I need to ask you this question right away. And I think I might be answering many of them. That's why I'm holding you. But one of the things that we are stuck to, or we find it very hard to leave the foods that we are eating, is because of our conditionings. And this all comes from things like this. You know, from our mothers. You're drinking milk because that's what your mother gave you. And most of us, looks like Google atmosphere, doesn't it? Okay, I'm not going to show you the whole ad, but you can see that I've only come through half the ad, which means it's a real long ad, and somebody's paying for this. Now, remember one thing. Anything that you really need, nobody needs to spend this much on advertisement, right? So, are we being told a lie again and again? And when a lie is repeated often enough, in our mind, it takes the form of truth. But anything that's being advertised, we need to look at it and see if it's really needed. Because there's no advertisement for carrots and oranges and apples and cucumbers. Why? Right? Every market can get well organized. It's all about... Listen, wait a minute.
Water is essential. You have advertisements for water.
Apple juice is there.
That's different.
No. You are having advertisements for branded water, not water. This is... Wait. Please, let me show you the whole ad. This is not branded milk. That's it. So, but if you walk past a chicken stall, you will see a banner. You will see the name. Every chicken stall will have a name. How come all the vegetable stalls don't? No, we're not talking about that. You know what I'm talking about.
They also have an organized sector which advertises their vegetables.
Reliance Fresh is not a vegetable stall.
It's
a supermarket chain. It's like McDonald's. Or okay, you know what I'm getting at. If you can't understand, then we'll go back.
I'm just giving you a compliment, saying that okay. Both have organized markets and they do have advertising.
Thanks for that. Okay. Plants today, okay. We passed this one. Are vegan products easily available in the market in India? And just to make you understand, actually, Indian diet does not need vegan products. Actually, they are available. You can get soy milk, but you can also get meat alternatives, artificial, fake meats like fries. You get fake chicken, burgers, whatever you want. But maybe not easily, maybe not on the road, maybe not in every shop, maybe in Reliance Fresh, I don't know. But actual Indian diet does not require vegan products. Our Indian diet is what? Dal, roti, sabzi, or chawal. What's non-vegan in that, you know? So we have changed, because of advertising, into a non-vegan diet. And it's very easy for an Indian to go back to a vegan diet. taste gratification is an issue for me. I don't think there's anything as tasty and as it should be as chicken or paneer in a vegan diet. How would you address these concerns? I'll tell you what I do. I realize that this is a very big issue. And when I used to give talks like these or other talks, I realized that many people found it, though they were enthusiastic about the idea of being vegan or idealistic about it, they thought it's too hard to do. And it often happened that right after my talk, people would go out and within 20 minutes, they were having a chai or an ice cream. And I said, wow, what am I doing? You know, until I started having workshops like the ones I do now, where I serve breakfast, lunch and snacks. And I serve a huge variety. It's a huge buffet. And the goal is to make people not only understand that there's a huge variety of vegan foods that are tasty, but, and there's plenty to eat, but that it's very, very tasty. And you know what comments I get every single workshop, especially in Oroville. In Oroville, when we do the workshops, we have volunteers who are cooking. They're not even professionals. But we just give them the recipes, we discuss the recipes before the whole process starts, and they lay out a banquet at lunchtime, and we have a, you know, smaller breakfast and smaller snacks, but a huge lunch. And almost every time I have heard, this is the best food I've eaten for ages. Now, one of the reasons our food is so great is because we use very high quality ingredients. Because I always make sure that everything's organic and of the highest quality. But the other reason is that it is part of our instinct, and I'm coming to that soon. It's part of our instinct to eat vegan. And so when you eat food that's well made and vegan, most people will say, oh, this is the best food I've ever had. So we do make some alternatives because people need them. For example, instead of milk, we have coconut milk or soy milk. And instead of cheese, we make our vegan cheeses and so on and so forth. But that's just because people feel that they need, if we do South Indian, you know, more for South Indians, then we surely make vegan curds and vegan buttermilk and so on and so forth. But that's just because people think that they need it. So they are, you know, a bit surprised to see a vegan version of it that tastes as good. But usually when people switch to vegan, they start making the alternatives, and after a few months, they drop off. And nobody is making any more vegan cheese or vegan curds or vegan, because you don't need them anymore. Once you realize, so it's just about conditioning. Once you realize that vegan food tastes good, you don't miss the other thing. And I've had people who have changed their diet from non-vegetarian 3 times a day, overnight, to vegan, and yet not using the alternatives within half a year. You know, all the alternatives drop off. Because actually, milk is a food for infants, right? Are we infants? Not really. So do we really need milk? Cow's milk is a food for, I often go to kindergarten and for them it's very easy to answer because I say, okay, dog's milk is a food for, and they'll say dogs, but then they'll say puppies and correct themselves. And then I say, okay, cat's milk is a food for, and they say kittens, and cow's milk is a food for, and they got it. It's as quick as that. But when you go to adults and you say cow's milk, it's a bit harder. Take some more time. Okay, would you agree that veganism is a fad and an attempt to ape the West, especially since most Indians are not aware of viable substitutes? And I would say it's the opposite. I would say that eating meat and dairy is an attempt to ape the West. When I was young, there was no cheese in India. Today, there's no restaurant without cheese. So eating meat and dairy is an attempt to ape the West. And our traditional Indian diet is vegan, 90% of it. If milk were less cruel, would you advocate it? In my hometown, several cows are not treated cruelly, and this has two parts. One is the cruelty aspect, and one is whether I would advocate it or not. And I would not advocate it because I'm a doctor and milk is not good for health reasons, which we don't have time to go into all these details, but just to give you a hint, heart disease reverses by cutting off milk, diabetes reverses from cutting off milk, cancer is prevented by cutting off milk. Today we are facing these three epidemics in India. But let's go to the cruelty aspect. In my hometown, there are several cows that are not treated cruelly. Now, people have told me this. I was in Calcutta once at a naturopathic center, and they said, you know, we have cows that are just outside our center, and they are not treated cruelly. And I said, please, I want to see these cows. Please take me to the dairy. And we, after much asking for it, they finally took me to the dairy. And it was the same story. There were no males there. The babies had been tied up and the mothers were being exploited. But even if really, really, people ask me this question, that what if we had our own cow? And the answer is, even if you have your own cow, you're going to go to work and have a cup of tea, and you're going to accept the sweets made from your friend or brought by your friends, or you go out for Diwali or you have a cake or maybe you have an ice cream. As long as you're addicted to milk and milk products, it's very hard to leave. Which also brings me to one more thing, that milk, meat, high protein is one of our addictions. If I say suddenly no more milk, everybody will say, oh, how can I live without it? And it's a very different feeling from if somebody tells you, okay, from today, no more carrots. So we have to also see, why is this? Are we addicted? And so on. For centuries, people have been drinking milk from cows. It is a fact that nutrients required by humans is different from other species. This is a fact. Actually, this is true. Nutrients required by humans are different from those of other species. Maybe man is different because of this. Is it necessary to compare us to other animals? You know, in nature, everything is connected. And this goes back to our plant-sensitive beings and also connecting to that question. Nature does not prefer any species over another. When a lion kills a zebra, it's not just good for the lion, it's good for the zebra as well. Because the lion can only get the weakest of the zebra, which means that it helps the species to strengthen. And this is nature or Darwin's law, or whatever you call it, to help the strengthening of the species. So every single species has its own niche. For example, when there were taller animals like giraffes and things, trees were being naturally pruned by them. Or goats have another specific group of plants that they eat, and cows eat something else, and human beings eat something else. So even if human beings are supposed to be vegan, if we were to look at what it would be the natural food for our species, if we were not industrialized, it would be fruits. And by fruits, I mean botanical fruits, that means fruits and vegetables, things that grow automatically and can be plucked and eaten. So it means fruits, berries, nuts, and seeds, basically. Today we're eating grains and things, but these are not really the foods meant for our species. If we were to eat, and that's also where this fruit juice bit came in, if we were to eat foods which were completely good for our species, we would be the healthiest that we can ever be. But we have learned to be like other animals by watching lion kills. Now, if you just think about it, whenever an animal in nature kills another animal, for example, if a cat kills a rat, which part of the rat does the cat eat? It eats the cat whole, from head to tail, leaving behind no skin, no bones, no hair, no drop of blood. But when we eat the animals, we do. We take off the skin, we take out the bones, we can't even cut it with our teeth, we hack it with a knife, we have to cook it in order to eat it. And to make it palatable, we dress it with plant materials like onion and garlic and mustard and ketchup and soya sauce. Could there be something wrong? Is it possible for the whole world to become vegan or vegetarian? Are you not pushing for the impossible? You know what? I'm not pushing for anything. Everybody can decide what they want to do. But I don't have the delusion that the world is going to become vegan because I gave a talk here or anywhere else overnight. And I do think that if we really want the world to survive, if we really want to cut down on climate change, if we really want a future for our children, a lot more people need to be vegan. And I'm very clear that if everybody ate meat, there would be no more world. How do people who live in the tundra or in Africa, where cultivation is so expensive, survive on a vegan diet? I love this question because no matter who asks it, they never live in the tundra or in Africa. I've been asked this question over and over again, and one of the reasons this question comes up is because we are looking for justifications to continue doing whatever we're doing. And so we immediately put our mind somewhere else and say, well, if they can, why can't we? And the true answer is, in Africa, it's very easy. I've been to Africa. I've been to a place where no cultivation was happening. It was in Senegal. And I've eaten the best pineapples and mangoes I've ever eaten in my life, and nobody was even cultivating them. They were just growing around. Now, those Africans were not vegans. They were killing a few monkeys and a few wild boars. They were eating anything they found, but the fruits there were amazing. But in the tundra. So if anybody wants to learn more about how you can be a vegan in the tundra, the best book to read is A Good Life. And A Good Life is a book about a couple in the US who bought a farm in upstate New York, where 6 months of the year it's winter, and decided to live without any monetary exchange. That means they could only eat what grew on their own farm or exchange with their neighbors next to them. And they started off as vegetarian. Within a year, they became vegan because they understood the implications of a vegetarian diet. And they described very clearly how they ate, what they ate. And you know, in the cold countries, there are many vegetables that grow. Autumn vegetables like carrots and pumpkins and turnips and cabbages, which you can keep in the basement or in cold storage, and they last through the whole winter. So if you want to understand how it can be done in the tundra, this is a really good book to read. But the shorter answer could be this. If you were to take a polar bear and put it in Singapore Zoo, would you feed it tropical fruit? What would you feed it? Fish. You would feed it the food which it was most used to. Human beings originated in the tropical regions. And even though we have gone to the temperate regions, our anatomy has not changed. And so even if we live in the Arctic, the healthiest food for us as a species is a plant-based diet. Now, this is a good one. Humans are omnivores. That's what we've been taught in school. How can we not survive on a plant and animal-based diet? And I just want to show you a few pictures to make you think about whether this is really true or not. So here's a picture of a carnivore, more carnivores, and a herbivore, and compare our teeth to that of a carnivore once again, and to omnivores. These are omnivores. And here you see real canines, canines that are hard to locate in your mouth. And still too hard, look in the mirror. But we have a lot of other anatomical features that clump us with herbivores and not omnivores, which are that we drink by sipping, like all herbivores, and not by lapping, as carnivores do, all of them. We have a different digestive system, which is a digestive system that's 12 times the length of our spine. Carnivores have 3 times the length of their spine. because animal products decay and should be sent out of the body as soon as possible. The other thing is that carnivores have a lot more acid in the stomach in order to kill all the bacteria on their prey and then digest all those bones and skin that we are not eating. But when we do consume animal products, we force our stomach to produce a lot of acid, thereby causing acidity. And we often aid it. That's why if you go for a McDonald's, what will you order to drink? Coke. Coke is pure acid. So because we don't have enough acid in our stomach, we add in. If you go to a French restaurant and order a steak, what will you order to drink? Another pure acid. So because we don't have the digestive enzymes to digest these things, we put it in as well. We also have a multicolored vision for a reason. Other animals don't, because we are supposed to eat foods from the whole rainbow every day. And this is why scenes like this are attractive to us. And also manufacturers know this and make all this attractive to us. We have living habits like herbivores. We live in groups. And we have desire for sweets. There's a reason for that, not because God wanted us to get diabetes, but because the best food for us is fruit and it's sweet. But we've learned to artificially sweeten everything which is bad for us. We also have herbivorous habits, like we eat several times a day, and so do herbivores. Cow or a horse grazes several times a day, but a carnivore kills its prey, eats it, and then doesn't eat for a long time. Lion may not eat for 10 days. So imagine if we eat the food which a carnivore would eat, but eat as often as a herbivore, aren't we going to get sick? Also, if you look at our instincts, if we walk through a farm, we are tempted to pick up these apples and eat them, or even beans if they're growing there, and we'll eat them raw. And you know, if you take your dog through the farm, there's no danger to the farm. But if you take your dog past these hens, there'll be a problem. And if we walk, if you see a hen, does your mouth water? Or a cow? Or a dead cow? It's only when it has been cooked in a way that we are conditioned to eating it, does it attract us. And manufacturers know this too, and that's why shampoos and lipsticks and lip gloss and soap is all smelling or has a flavor of cherries and strawberries and lime and flowers, but never barbecue and chicken and so on. Okay, I've got to skip this, and this we'll just, okay. Basically, now I want to go back to the questions that people were asking.
Some cows just giving 2 liters for the thing. Like I also come from village. I had like for like 8 or 10 cows and buffalo. Many died naturally, and I know clearly that there are some kind of species in cows or buffalo which gives you less milk.
Absolutely. You know what? I'm not debating that. And the number of cows which Latika has are all rescued, so there's a mixture of cows. She hasn't been breeding them. What I want to say is that even in the village, I live in a village. I come from Oroville. I live in a village. Right outside my office are cows and babies of cows. And I'm seeing what happens to them, and I know what happens in the villages. Okay? You bring me the pictures of those cows. The calf is tied up on a rope 1 foot long. The cow is tied on another rope 1 foot. The mother and the baby are not together. We are talking about unexploited cows. That means after the calf drinks all the milk of its mother, then you take the milk. We are not talking about taking all the milk and then counting the liters. Okay?
Have you owned any cows as a fellow? Like, do you know that like, if we leave the calf, like we have done, right? Mm-hmm.
I love your question. I love your question. And my his question is that, you know, have you ever owned cows? Because we know that if the calf is left with its mother, it cannot digest the milk, all the milk, right? Wait a minute. The person who's running our farm said the same thing. Until he heard my talk, and he was running a small dairy, and he left the dairy. Because the truth is not that. We are forcing the cows to produce more milk by various ways, and then, but if you leave the calf with the mother, the calf is not going to get sick. This is something that people are saying. But have you ever left the calf with the mother to see that it gets sick? Because the calf does not get sick when it's left with its mother. No baby over takes too much. No baby takes more than its needs.
Yes, means like, I was just wondering, like, because...
No.
Yeah, it is like real experiment, because I live from village. Maybe my village is a bit more backward than we don't have electricity yet. So,
yes.
Like, I'm like really on that old village. Are there like some records, like, about that living calf? We can think about that.
No. Let's go back to this. You know what? You are going to send me the result of this experiment. So when you go back to the village, you cut off all those ropes and see, tell me how many calves fall sick.
So what we do is like now less, but earlier we used to have like when we have the book fellow, like lot, we take like earlier, like people take like at 6 or 7 in the morning, go for the grazing, they come back in evening, definitely tied. But when they go, no tied.
Baby is tied?
No. Everything goes together,
okay.
Everything comes together at evening.
Mm-hmm.
After that, like, so they have like full 12 hours or like 9 hours, whatever you say.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, they are tied again in the night time. Like, for me, it is logically like I'm also tied in my home, though not literally, but like my parents never allow me to go and play for like longer period. And
I'll tell you something.
So, like, I think that was a bit logical, but we have seen that still on that 12 hour where the fellow has full time for the feeding, it still gives like some 6 liters or 8 liters milk both times.
Okay, I'll tell you something. Please, go back to your village.
No, I just came back, so I can go.
Well, go after 6 months. Go after 6 months. We are not in a hurry to verify all this, okay? And logically verify these things. Okay? Okay, because I, you know what, I'll tell you something. I know 3 people who are running dairy, who left the dairy when they heard this. Whatever, same. They had minor dairies.
Like, yes, I'll verify.
Okay.
Other things like for example...
You know what, can we just rotate? Because otherwise we'll be left only to you.
This is on behalf of people who are convinced about giving it a try at least.
Yes.
So I fall into the category which is most conditioned to drinking milk, coffee, tea.
Right.
So in terms of like an experiment, if you could like offer substitutes during those times when there is a strong urge.
Right.
Like I can't live without curd.
I understand.
Recipes and stuff like that, like, you know, you talked about vegan milk,
right.
Which is interesting.
You know what? The recipes are on our website, okay? www.sharan-india.org. However, no matter how many recipes you see there, until you taste it, it doesn't go in properly. You know, you say, oh, vegan milk, soy milk, I mean... I don't know if, you know, there are people who try soy milk and say, I don't like it. And I'll tell you the answer to that. If you have been having whole milk and suddenly have skim milk, has anyone had this experience?
No, I still don't take skim milk.
Okay, skim milk tastes horrible if you've been having whole milk, right? But if you've been having skim milk, like 80% of people in USA, if you suddenly have whole milk, what does it taste like? And it tastes like paint. It's too, right? So it's all about conditioning. When you start having soy milk, you may not like it. But if you have soy milk every day for 21 days, you'll say, I like soy milk. Nothing wrong with soy milk, you know? So it's a little bit about conditioning. See, any change is hard. If suddenly you are told, okay, now you leave Google Hyderabad and go to Google, I don't know where, even that change will be hard. If you are told to change your house, it can be hard. Any change is hard. But once you get into it, it's very easy. So the only solution that I know for this, and this is what I do, is have cooking classes and potlucks and things like that so that people, you know a way and have support. Yes. You know, the transition all depends on where are your roadblocks. So if you could tell me where your roadblock is first.
I'm a vegetarian, but I drink milk and I eat eggs and all that.
Right.
So that could be the roadblock if I want to eat a vegan diet.
Very good. So this is your roadblock because taste. Now, what are you sensitive to? Anything, you tell me, just anything. What are you sensitive in the world to? If what kind of things would make you upset?
Oh, any creativity that
I see. Oh, good. Then no problem for you. Then I would advise you, just go on our website, www.sharan-india.org, go to resources section. Look at the very first video, which is a video from Peter on dairy. You stop the milk, no problems. Okay. Welcome. Yes. Yeah. So I want to answer this question scientifically. Scientifically, we don't need any milk. Okay. Because the best milk for human beings is human milk till we're weaned. And now, since we're no more calves or any baby, we don't need any milk. So, soy milk is a substitute only for taste or when you want to replace something. But don't think that, oh, if I drop milk, I need to substitute with soy milk. Your health will improve. You know, many times in India, you see people with big buttocks, almost buffaloes waddling around, right? And one of the reasons is milk, because milk contains a very potent growth hormone, which makes the baby grow from, you know, you've seen a calf baby being born, and how many pounds it increases in just 18 months. So it contains growth hormone, and this growth hormone is very similar to human growth hormone. And works in the same way in our body. So even if you don't become vegan and you just stop milk products, you will find reduction in weight and all this slowly melting, slowly. You know what I would advise instead is a mixture of all kinds of milk, like coconut, sesame, soy. Why to give one? Almond milk, oat milk, rice milk, mix them all, give it, you know. All the recipes are on our website. But you reminded me of one thing and now it skipped my mind. I'm sorry, I forgot. There was something I wanted to say. Forgot. Okay. Actually, they're very, very easy to make, even more easily accessible than going out, buying the milk, bringing it, boiling it, putting it in the fridge. To make almond milk, for example, is less costly than cow's milk. Doesn't sound like, but it's true, because you need about 10 almonds soaked overnight. That's easy because they soak themselves if you put a little water. And then you put it in a blender, just blend it into a paste, and add water to it. Now, if you want to do it even easier way, there's even an easier way, which, you know, somebody like that mother could do, is take a lot of almonds together and put it in a blender and make it into an almond butter. Even easier, go to a store and buy almond butter. Take a spoon of this, put it in the blender, put in water, and you have a glass of almond milk. It's that simple, you know. It's even simpler than going to buy the milk and putting it in the fridge and boiling it and all. But to make a change in our minds is not simple. That's the roadblock. I would like to answer the question which he asked me, you, right? Which I wanted to use the board for. May I go to that side?
I have a question actually.
Yeah.
So how much research has basically been done to show that milk aids in cancer and health?
I wish I had much more time. Actually,
and also if it's true, then why don't we have warnings over that, saying that too much milk can cause?
I love that question. Okay, thank you for the question. You know, there are all kinds of things that come up. Just to give you a similar thing, you know, often you open your email and you say, you read about dangers of soy. Have you ever read? Oh, they don't come to you. Oh, maybe I didn't get the last few questions or something. But anyway, you get emails talking about the danger of soy as if soy is a bioweapon or something like that, right? And talks about how soy has phytoestrogens and those estrogens can cause cancer and so on and so forth. Now, we often don't stop to think about whether this is true or not. Like, soy has been used for centuries. Soy is just a bean. It's like all your dals. Can it be that bad? So, similarly, we often don't examine the things about milk, you know? Now, actually, all the research has been done. Have you heard of Benjamin Spock? Benjamin Spock was a pediatrician of my parents' time. Maybe you have heard of him.
Dr. Spock,
very well-known pediatrician all over the world. In his books, he has repeatedly written that milk is bad for health. Everybody who is in the field of child health has read Benjamin Spock's book. Research has been done, loads and loads of it, but until you see it, until you know, you don't read it. Let me put it this way. You know, when we were doing the 21-day residential program, during that period, about 4 or 5 times, my participants said, oh, look, what you're saying is in the newspaper. I said, I read this every day. The unfortunate thing is the opposite is also there in the newspapers every now and then, you know. So nobody knows what to believe. But what I'm saying was, in the newspaper, the research has been done, but until you have heard it, they had not read it before, even though it's coming every day. So it's something like this, you know, same thing happened to me. I left milk because I understood that cows are being artificially inseminated, which means rape. Their babies are being taken away from them, and mammals, for them, the closest thing is their baby. And we are taking the milk. So I said, I don't want to be a part of this. I left milk. As soon as I left milk, I started seeing all the scientific articles I hadn't seen before. And now I can tell you all the science. But if you would like to know the science, you should come to Peas versus Pills on Saturday. That's all I can say. I can't finish it in another 2 minutes. You know? Yes.
Largely populated countries like India.
Yeah.
Getting into this vegan.
Yeah.
There won't be any overcultivation which is affecting this ecosystem.
In fact, it'll be just the opposite. Because what overcultivation? No, because we will be culting the what? As soon as we stop growing all the food for the cows, we can grow our vegetables in this much portion. I'm staying with a lady here in Hyderabad. She's growing in this small patch enough palak to feed her family almost every day of the week. You need much more less land to grow plants than to grow. That would be lovely. Actually, I'm going to put it up on the board there, so
yeah,
it's done. I just want to say that before you bombard me with emails, there is a section on our website called Try Vegan. And there we answer a lot of these common questions, a lot of which haven't come up today, but which are important. For those of you who are thinking of going on a vegan diet, it would be really, really important to look at this section. So this is a website. /India, not underscore, .org. And look under the section on the home page called Try Vegan.